All right, hello. Everybody hear me? Can't hear me. Check, check. Should be working. Sorry for the delay. There's some technical. There we go. I think you guys can hear me now. All right. So, how's everybody doing this morning? I'm gonna try to keep my eye out on the chat. Cool. Just had the homie tell me. All right, word, heard you. Right, how many people we got in here? 24. Word. So, I'll get us all start. My name's Matt. I'm from Crisis Era. I'm a music maker dude. I'll be teaching you guys some stuff about bass and mostly just sound design as well. It applies everywhere. Just let me know how this audio is. You guys hear that all loud and clear? Cool. Cool. All right. So, where to start? I don't really have anything super planned, but I will try to walk from the basics all the way to some more advanced stuff. Try to prepare some basic demos, just so we can hear bass in different contexts. So a lot of it is kind of, especially in EDM and like electronic dance music and like even in a lot of like pop production, sound design is like a lot of educated guessing because like all this stuff that they teach you in like sound engineering school and yeah, like SAE and like places like that. They'll teach you the fundamentals, and then it's up to you to kind of bend the fundamentals to get something no one else has gotten before. And a lot of times it's hard to kind of make it exactly how you want it. So with a lot of like professional producers, what we do is we play around and like we make decisions based on like experience and like previous knowledge. And then we try to like, try to get something cool, and then once we do have something cool, then we use other techniques to like clean things up. So like I haven't done a lot of sound design sessions in a while because I've been busy doing a lot of mixing projects for clients. But like sound design and mixing, they go hand in hand. Like you gotta kind of know both to make the perfect sound, and so let's just start and like warm up our brains with no, I gotta move everything to this one screen because I know you guys can only see one screen. I got like too many screens. All right, so let's just get a serum going. So I prepared some basic drums. Let's start with some housey shit. All right. So you all know, obviously, that there is the basic waves, right? So we got sine, saw, square, triangle, and all this good stuff. So the sine is basically a fundamental waveform. So if you look at it on a spectrum analyzer, I'm not going to pull up a bunch of spectrum analyzers just because it's a waste of screen space. But you should invest into one and look at your sounds visually on like an analyzer, and that will tell you what you're doing to the sound and how it's changing it. So when you look at a sine on a spectrum, let me just pull up just a basic filter. You see, it's just like one harmonic right here, right? And if you change the pitch, it's gonna go up, and it's just like that fundamental frequency. And that's kind of the bones of your bass. And then by changing the waveform, you're going to be adding more harmonics. So saw, see, he's got all these like new harmonics. And what that's doing is giving more information in the kind of the field of sound. And it's going to come out through a lot more speakers, right? But it still has that fundamental note. So there's a technique called sine compression for sound design, and what it does is pretty much compresses a sine and like flattens it, and when you do that, you actually get a square. So a square is like a really pressed sine wave, and actually it's a great place to start to design some shit, right? And I know a lot of house producers who do use like square pretty much like everywhere. So square sounds like this. Like, it's already kind of fat, you know, like I could see the potential in it. So let's just do something super basic to warm up. So with a lot of it, like I said in my previous like videos, you want to kind of roll off the top because it's kind of dirty, especially if you're going to be distorting things later. And then, just to keep things simple for now, we can give it a diode distortion. You guys can hear that, right? Let me just check the chat real quick. I love your music. It's good stuff. Thanks, dude. Love you. Where do I find my sounds? The sounds... So I like to sound design every patch. As for like loop samples and stuff, and like just samples, I like supporting other artists who like record different sounds. I like Native Instruments shit is lit. So if you got the money, buy the Native Instruments stuff. Yeah, so you just gotta keep your eye out on a bunch of stuff, and then keep a sound like a library with all your samples. So I got like a little library with like a bunch of stuff that I just developed and accumulated over the years. Anyway, let's get back to this. So yeah, so after we got this distortion, there's like a not much you like here. Let's try this. By the way, I don't really have any kind of particular idea about this. So we'll just fuck around, you know, because educated guessing. So let's hear this. That's already kind of cool. Like, I like that. Now, let's send a sub direct out. Remember when I talked about that fundamental frequency? So this is going to get distorted and it's going to spread out a bit and it's going to like get moved around. So we want to send a sub, just that fundamental frequency that we saw right here. Remember that? We want to send that directly out so it doesn't get affected by all these things. That will give us like a tighter low end. So let's see how that sounds. Cool, right? That's like kind of G. So let me just make a small MIDI. Jesus, I'm not used to this one screen thing. Right. And don't worry, I'm gonna get more interesting soon. I know this is basic stuff, but we all gotta, you know, warm up. I'm just drinking my coffee, you know, chilling, having a good, you know, morning. Here, I got a basic MIDI going, so let's hear it. Right, word. So let's add a mono legato. That's gonna give you that glide right here, where I have those. Yo, fuck, get out of the way. Disgusting. All right. Yeah, so as you can hear, that's kind of like what Loopers does. So, yeah, with like some finessing and stuff, you can get a pretty thick sound from a square. Another thing that squares are good for is trap and like mid-tempo. And like that sounds super popular these days. So I prepared a little snippet here just because like I didn't want to do all the sequencing on stream because it's kind of boring. You're just laying out fucking drums and shit. So here, I got something for you. So I just kind of threw that together last night. But the main thing here I wanted to show you is that this bass, god damn it, oh my god, this bass right here, it's also a square. And it's fucking simple, you know? So, well, let me look at the chat again. Let's see, Serum is godsend. Yeah, Serum is lit. I also, like, yeah, man, Serum is good. I'll show you guys later some other plugins that I use. But Serum is just, like, so intuitively clean that I always like default to it for, especially for demonstrating stuff. Because if I was to show you sound design in like Falcon, or I'm gonna show you a sound in FM8 later, because I think FM8 gives you the richest saws from like a VST, like a digital plugin that I've seen. But yeah, so FM8's great for like Reese's and stuff. So I'm gonna show you how to make a Reese bass later. But I heard good things about like other phase plugins. I just like Serum, and yeah. And if I was to show you how to design in Falcon, we'd be here for like the next 4 hours trying to figure out how to fucking do granular synthesis. That's, yeah. But if you have time and money, get Falcon, because it's a fucking sick plugin. Let me quickly show you what it looks like. And shit. Where is it? Blind Boss. There it is. I'm not going to do any design in this today, but if you have, yeah, if you're interested, this is a beast. It's insane. All right. So let me go back to the chat real quick. YFL Studio. You know, me and Silas started in Logic. And then we moved to Studio One. Then I've done some work in Cubase. And then, like, I have Ableton. And I have Cubase still. I don't know. I just really like the playlist. Like, this function where I can just drag shit around just, like, anywhere I want. And then just, like, forget about sequencing, like, on the line. I got used to that. And, like, I have ADD. And, like, not, I don't think I clinically have ADD. But, like, I'm a bit all over the place. And it just like feels good to just move shit around and just see how things sound instead of being like trapped to like the whole track thing. There are a lot of downfalls of FL Studio, especially with like stem exports, because things are a lot all over the place. So if you want to do a stem mix down, it's like brutal. But, you know, fuck it. You think of getting Ableton? Yeah, Ableton's dope, dude. Everybody uses Ableton. Like all the big boys use Ableton. So, you know. Fucking, it's great DAW. It just really depends. You gotta try a bunch of stuff out. I think they have a lot of think they have a lot of different free trials for all of them. And just if you have a friend, just come over to their house and be like, yo, can I try out your FL Studio for a couple hours? And then you just see what you like, you know. For some people, some things might work. For others, other things work, you know. I have a lot of friends who use fucking Bitwig. And, yeah, it's like a trippy, duh. You can do anything in anything, honestly, because it's like it's just the platform that you're designing on. Anyway, let's get back to this base. So, as I was saying, this thing's a square. Oh my God, fuck out of the way, Mike. Nothing special going on right here. What that shit, the hyphy quicks slash like mid-tempo guy thing's coming from. It's that Combs filter. And I talked about it in a recent video, but dude, that thing is just beast. So what I'm doing here is I'm adding dimension for a bit of that stereo. Like that little roomy ring to it. Then obviously tube distortion, because I like tube distortion. The Combs filter. And then compressing it all together. And I'm sure you guys are smart beeps. You guys know what all those things are. I don't have to like go into detail about it. Word. So that's a basic breakdown of that. So I wanted to do something more chill, just to like have like a little break from bangers. So I sequenced this little loop, and I'm going to show you how to make a pad that you can just throw into your mixes, especially like if you have vocal parts and stuff. Like sometimes you need some body to fill up the low end with, but you don't want to use like a bass, and you don't want to use like a nice light pad. So I like these things. They're called like Reese pads, I guess. I don't really know. But yeah, it like really fills out the sequence for me. Here, like, I made this loop. Would you look at that? Pulled up a serum again. All right, so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to give some stereo information to the saw. Then, so how you would get this to this point, starting from scratch, you'd be like, all right, what does this sound like? I'm like, oh, okay, so it's like a nice fucking Reese-y kind of sound going on. So what can I do to it? Oh, I need to have a bit more layers, so it's like, so it feels a bit more spread, right? So you can, you know, add another oscillator. And like, this is what I mean when I'm talking about like educated guessing, because like, I don't really know what I'm gonna create in the end. I just know the kind of the feeling of it in my head first. And then I know which waveforms sound in certain ways, right? So like, I know a saw is gonna have those like spikes on the top, and like, it's gonna be kind of fuzzy in the middle. And I know a square is going to be like pressed to the top, and it's going to have those like hard clicks. And then I know a sine is going to be like just a clean fundamental, right? So I try to manipulate the sound to head towards a direction. Like if I know I'm going to add more voices, I know it's going to sound a bit more like detuned and full. If I know I'm going to filter it, it's going to cut off the high end, you know, like if I'm going to, you know, automate some stuff, it's going to move, you know? So, let's like do a bend. So what a bend does, it kind of pushes the peaks of the wave together. So if I was to full bend it, it's going to start resembling a triangle, a sine, you know what I mean? So I want to kind of get like a wave that's like in the middle almost. Anyway, so let's see. See, now without that, it's missing that like weird like mid-tone creaminess to it. So if you add that, you got, and you know I'm a sucker for my direct out low end, because you know you just gotta have that low end scent. And then let's have a little dip. So you know, all you guys know what ADSR is, not ADSM. But yeah, you know what this is. It's just like your attack, decay. So at this point, it's got too much high end, right? So I want to clean that up, because I don't want this high end to be interfering with my drums, because I'm, we're just trying to make like a little bass pad. So that's when you would go for the filter, right? Because it's the easiest way to clean things up. Price that. Drives are always good if you don't want to distort things too much. Cool. So let's move on to some effects. Okay. So here you can, it really depends on what kind of style you want to make. If you don't want to distort it too much, then you can like leave out the distortion. But I like to distort things just a little bit, just to like press things up and give it more of like an analog feel. Because like tube is not going to really fuck your shit up. Like it's mostly like the zero square and the sine folds and the linear folds and the diodes that are going to like really distort your signal. So let's do something like that. Let's add a chorus just because, spread it even more. Let's give it a glide because pads are sick when they glide. You see that Reese-y aspect to it, you know? So that's because these waves with the random, they're interacting with each other, and they're starting into like, at some peaks they're meeting up, and then at some there's like troughs. So those like areas where the peaks are doubling up, that's giving you like a whoom, 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 whoom. So it's giving you that like feeling of oscillation, and that's like, you know, the backbone of a Reese. So I have this low end direct out, right? So I'm gonna have low end onto my send on my channel, right? So I'm gonna clean it up and kind of reduce the low end on the affected parts, which are these two oscillators, and then I'm gonna also reduce the high end because we don't really need it. And now I'm just going to find like a nice sweet spot where the low end is not booming anymore. And then, I don't know, we can use a filter to kind of drive it a bit more. And that's kind of going to give you like the basic Reese pad. So if I was to show you what it sounds like in context, let me just quickly make a MIDI. Let's do something like this. I don't like how that sounds. Let's spread this a bit. Oh, jeez. All right. Yeah, let's try this out. And, like, obviously, the sequence I would have, not, like, a stem, obviously. I would have the bass being sidechained by the signal from the kick, just so, like, they don't overlap. So right now, I'm just going to do ghetto style, and I'm going to just automate the volume. So like this is what a sidechain would do, right? So you would have the signal from this kick coming in, and then when that would be playing, this bass would not be playing. So you don't have those collisions in the low end, because kicks have a lot of low end. Like kick drums, you know, they have low end. So yeah, I'm just going to quickly sidechain that in this ghetto way. You know, I would never do this in a track. It's just because I don't have the drums. All right, so let's see what it sounds like. I'm going to check the stream for comments. Oh shit, banger, my bad. You see I'm like tweaking it a bit with the mix itself. It's because like I didn't really have an idea prior to making the sound. Like I had an idea, but I didn't know how it was gonna sound in the context. So yeah, that's a bass pad, and it's super effective. Like it doesn't even have to be in like a drop section. It could be under a vocal. I use that in breaks a lot. So yeah. All right, let's see what else we got. Okay, let's see. I have to try Logic because that's so hard. Logic is not hard, dude. You got it. Okay, classic strong bass, the Chrysler sound. I don't know if I have like a direct approach. I can suss it out later. We're going to get into some more detailed stuff soon. I don't have friends that do music. They hate your music. Well, your friends have small dicks. This is Dutch hip hop. Whatever. This is music for everyone, you know? How do you get stems for Disarm You? I think it was like a remix pack that went around, so I just hopped on it, dude. And then, yeah, it was cool. Don't offer that too. Yellow Claw merch. Yo, just fucking cop their merch, dude. It's good shit. Yeah, the gray jacket's sick. I got one too. I got a bunch of fucking gray jackets. Really warm. Do you guys ever crack plugins, DAWs, etc? Yo, if I say it on the stream, am I gonna get in trouble? I think. So these days, obviously, I don't, because we make money from music, and it just feels like a fucking asshole thing to do, to be like pirating stuff and then making money from music and then not giving back to the community and stuff. But when I was starting up and shit, I'm not gonna say no. Yeah. Can we do a collab with Stolten Huff? Yeah, dude, we have a collab with Stolten Huff, but currently we're working on something with Psycho Boys Club, which is Julian and Stolten Huff, so it's gonna be sick. Really love their work. Fucking great guys, talented. Love to work with them. All right, let's keep moving. So, since there's a buddy who said Dutch hip hop and his friends like it, I have a really, really basic sequence right here. It's more like hip hop drummy. But what I wanted to talk to you about is like 808s, and like everybody's hyped on the 808 sound these days. So here. So, super basic, made it in like 10 seconds. What I wanted to talk to you about is getting yourself an emulator. So, if you didn't know, 808s, they are, it's like a hardware synth that used to make like drums. And it's by Roland. And that's where like all the standard kind of hip hop percussion, drums, kicks, low end, like came from, right? It's like a hardware product. It's not synthetic. And then there are things like, such as this emulator, and there's obviously like samples from like an actual 808 that you can find online. But a lot of the times, like the 808 that you find online has already been processed by somebody else. And like, that's nothing wrong with that. Because, like, dude, like, everybody in the pop industry just uses already processed samples. Like, nobody gives a shit about being, like, the unique nerd. But it's super, like, handy to just learn from, like, a really simple send. So let me just turn off some of these effects. Like, what it sounds like, right? Because it's just, this is it. Like, that's an 808. And, like, if you can turn that into something cool, like something saturated, you have, like, so much freedom and you can make any kind of bass. And then, like, whatever direction you want to go with the 808, you can make it, like, roomy, big, fucking booming. It's handy to have an emulator around or like, clean samples. Another plugin I want to quickly mention is this plugin. It's called Kick. So I use this a lot. And the best thing about it, so let me just get something going real quick. I'll show you what it does. So the best thing about it is how flexible it is. Like, so I was talking earlier about having a visualizer to look at your waveform. You can do that to other producers' music, right? You know that. So if you have, like, a bass that you're super interested in, like, breaking down and, like, understanding yourself, you can load that up in like a visualizer and then look at the actual waveform, like, look inside the kick or the bass or whatever you want to recreate and just look at what it looks like. So, like, this is a sine wave, right? So it's wee. And then with this plugin, so you turn off all these clicks. This is, like, the kick part of your kick drum. And this is, like, the tail, right? That's the sub. So with this, you have the control over the harmonics, like, super directly. So if I do this, so, like, this is the second harmonic, third, fourth, fifth, blah, blah. And then I zoom in. You see how it changes the waveform? So see that, that's like a triangle almost. So you can look at the send from your bass that you like, and you can almost, like, recreate it visually on here. And then there's a great distortion in this plugin. There's a great drive. So, and I'll show you what the harmonic is. So, yeah, great, fuck off. Yeah, anyway, cool plugin. Get with it. If you don't know how you can do key shift, took me a long time to figure this out, but there's a little button right there, and then you can go in the MIDI and it'll play, like, respective notes. Anyway, just a little aside, cool plugin. All right, so I only have about 15 minutes left with you guys because I got another appointment, but I wanted to go over FM8 because I think it's a super dope synth, and I'll answer some questions after this and, like, maybe show some, you know, detailed things about something more specific to, like, the Crisis era sound, but really quickly, I wanted to show you how I, like, process the sound all the way through, not just, like, inside the plugin, but, like, also on the channel rack. So this is FM8. If you don't know it, you should get to know it. It's a cool plugin. It's pretty old school, and it uses operators instead of oscillators, which is kind of like, I don't know, meh to me. But it's, you know, it gives such a rich sound that, like, you kind of want to just deal with it. I don't know how to explain. Noisia use it, so, you know, if Noisia use something, it's pretty dope. So this is the filter operator, so I'll explain everything later. So the way FM8 works is that you have these operators, and they're right here, and each one is like a, you know, like a send, like in Serum, you have your oscillator 1 and 2, or A and B. So that's what operators are in FM8. So you see here, you can select all these waveforms and wavetables that go through FM8. And then here's your like output. So you gotta like link things through. I'm not gonna get into too much detail because it's not an FM8 tutorial. I just wanted to show you like another way you can make bass, because yeah, there's just so many ways. So you activate them by right clicks. So now let's see, we got our fundamental right here on F. And since we're doing a Reese, I think I'm gonna frequency modulate a sine with a triangle, because they're kind of similar waveforms. And by what frequency modulation is, it like you feed an input from one wave one wave into another, and it kind of modulates it, you know, and it gives you a cool sound. So I'm gonna do a triangle into a sine. And then to really kind of get those like artifacts, you're gonna wanna displace the pitch, which is like the speed of the oscillation of the waveform, to give you like the little, I don't know, modulation. I don't know, I don't know how to explain it. Maybe it's because I'm just waking up, but it's, yeah. Anyway, so here, this is the amount of like send that you're giving from one wavetable to the other. So this is what it sounds like so far. Pretty basic. But then we can feed the sine back onto the send. So this is going to modulate this, and this is going to modulate that. And it's making like a little modulation loop. Here, let me open the filter a bit. So you start hearing those like movements. It's like wow, wow, wow. And that's giving all those like weird like artifacts on top. So here, if I speed this up, it's gonna start going faster. Listen. So this is where like the design part comes from. You just gotta like trust your ears and just fuck around with things and like know the calculated guesses that you're making. So I'm gonna get into the sine, move this a bit even. Right, so we got like the basic kind of Reese going. And hold on, I'm gonna get a drink. My throat's hurting. Sorry. All right, so I think it's filtering a bit too much. Let's give it a bit of a spread here. Turn that down. So now I want to have like a little hit in the beginning. And then here you have to adjust like the range that the pitch wheel goes to. See here how there's like those flickering like boom, 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 boom. They start speeding up. That's the key to like a really tight Reese. You can make such cool things with this. You can use band notch filters and a bunch of filter movements to make these sounds pop. And like this will make your fills in your tracks or your fucking, you can like a drop. This is a drop sound as well. It'll make it so, so sick. And that's what like drum and bass and neuro bass is like super known for. Anyway, what I really like about FM8 is their stock plugins that it comes with, especially like the overdrive. Is super, super tight. It gives you like a really analog sound. And then my favorite is the phaser, because yeah, I don't know, this phaser just so dope. Gives you that like fucking wet, juicy sound. And then I feel like the EQ could be boosted a bit. Anyway, so that's the basic structure of it, right? So now I want to go into like a channel and then show you how to like break things down. So let me just get a little piano roll going. All right. Let's just do this. Okay, so here. Okay, so once I have this on a channel, I talked about this low end being tight, right? So what I'm doing here is I am splitting the send into two channels. You see that? So this is the send and it's going into two other channels. And then I'm gonna group them again after. So it's starting from one channel, going into two, and then it's coming back and meeting on one. This one is gonna be my low end. So I'm gonna, there's better plugins to do this because EQ actually has a crossfade region, which is kind of dirty, but whatever. So I cut out the highs in here, right? So this is going to be my bass, my like sub channel. And then this is going to be my mid to high range. So this is called parallel processing. So you kind of, you're processing the two different regions in parallel. And this is going to save your sound from being like, from the low end being like really disgusting. So since I'm only working on this channel right now, and I know it's my sub channel, I'm gonna mono it, right? That's already mono. There you go, lit. So, but just in case, you know, you want to mono things, this is a cool plugin to do it. You zero width below, you just set where you want to set it to zero, and then so here, this is my mid. So I don't really have a plan right now, but usually what I'd start with is I'd like try to find a cool region to distort. Saturn is a great distortion plugin. Let's just try saturation real quick. Gonna spend too much time on this part because this is where like the time really starts going. You start spending like hours designing these things, doing like filter EQs and like, you know, just to make things super interesting. But like basically there's a lot of muddiness around this region, usually like around 400 and around like 130, so it's good to like do small dips and then bring in the crispiness from the highs there, and then we can saturate it again. So see these two channels are meeting up on this one, so what I'm going to do here is I'm going to glue them together. And this plugin is called The Glue, but it's just a compressor. You can use any compressor. I'll show you a couple of my other favorite compressors. What do we got? There's the C1, but that's really tight for vocals. There's the HCOM from Waves. This is a sick compressor. Yeah, you got the C1. I like The Glue for a lot of the EDM stuff. So let's just set our ratio. Right, okay, so now the mid is starting to sound like really mono, and I want that like stereo information in it, right? So a bunch of different things you could do, like I'm just gonna fuck around with the delay. So no particular reason I chose to do this. I'm just like, you know, fuck it, why not? So this is a cool trick Silas mentioned in one of his tutorial videos. So what I'm doing right now is I'm delaying it slightly by a really short amount. So listen. Mid. Stereo information. You can tweak the width. You know what I mean? Fucking cool. So you can do that. Yeah. Anyway. Let me see the chat again. All right. Use some instruments. Yo, man. I did. I used instruments earlier, dude. Fucking drums and shit. Like, what do you want me to do? You want me to use, like, what, like, guitars and stuff? You want me to jam out? I don't know, dude. Like, here's some other percussive things if you're just joining in. And then we have the sub. Fuck you and your instruments, dude. What software are you using? I'm using FL Studio. Where's Sesco? I don't know, Danny. Where you at? Boit? Probably in Amsterdam somewhere. Yo, what the fuck? Can't read the bottom of this chat. Come up. Shit. What's going on? Oh, there we go. Got it back. Where did the skipping the first beat come from? Yo, okay, so that's a good question, dude. Honestly, I don't know, dude. Like, there was like a bunch of big room guys that started it, I think. I don't know, maybe not, probably not. But I think it's the whole impact, right? Because when you have the kick and it's just biting through with no other sounds, maybe like a fill, like oof, or like fucking a saw stab or whatever those things, it give you impact to the face and you're like, oh shit. And then there's no drop sound. You're like, oh, what's going on? Like, is there hesitation after this big buildup? And then the bass comes in. You're like, oh, like, let's go. Fucking right. So maybe it's the whole like surprise aspect to it. Okay, let's see. So what bass are you designing right now? A lead bass or sort of intro thing? I don't know what time that stamp was, but just recap for what I did today. Started with like a square house thing, like more loopers kind of shit. Then we did like one of these chill bass pads. Then we did this like mid-tempo trap Combs bass. Blah, 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 blah. And then we did just an 808. And then I was just designing this Reese, right? So this sound itself, like obviously it's fucking dirty right now. I need to spend a lot more time processing it. But like I showed you the basic concept of what you would do. Like you'd, you know, keep your low and mid and then start spreading your highs and your mids and stuff. And then you come bring it back together with like a compressor. So like this kind of sound, we use it in a lot of our breaks. So let me just play something real quick, and this is a sneak peek and you're not allowed to tell anyone. You promise not to tell anyone? Damn, dude. All right, so we'll be right back. Right. I got carried away. I was reading the old comments. So yeah, what my point here was first of all, is I wanted to show you guys the track. But second of all is I wanted to show you this part. So we had somebody else earlier ask, "What the hell are you making this reese for?" Well, for that, like this part's in a track, you might want to add like a cool reese, and you'd be like, "Yeah." You can also add it as fills. In the middle, I did that in Naughty, I think, a bunch of reese fills. Sorry. Sneaky plays most of it. Yo, whatever, dude. It's fucking stream quality anyway. I know you guys are gonna support and listen. Anyway, yeah, so that's what you'd use the reese for. Do I master my tracks myself? No, I do not. I mix everything down. I do stem mix downs and stuff. But I feel like when it comes to mastering, you want somebody with different set of ears to just listen to your track and like adjust it to the way they kind of want to hear it as well. Because you after you've worked on something for like 10 years and you've listened to it like 1,000 times, you can't trust your ears anymore for a lot of the stuff. So, yeah, I don't master myself. Let's see. Hi guys, love your music. Thank you, noob gamer dude. Something with Texas. Yeah, I'm fucking down. I wanted to make something pretty hard. I've been like almost getting back into like the older sound of Crisis Era just to like fuck around. Gravedigger. I don't know. I don't know who he is. Like I know who he is. I just never talked to him. So, anyway, yeah. So I'm gonna start wrapping up, because I gotta go. But if you guys have any kind of other questions, I can try answering them. Some people are scared to ask for feedback. Yeah, but like, fuck it, you tried your best, or like even if you didn't try your best, it's like it's so, still cool to show somebody else what you did. And like mastering engineers, they're gonna take your track and they're gonna do their best with it. Like it's not their job to like critique it. They're just gonna try to clean things up. They usually it helps, mastering helps. Yeah, Chrysler and Sega Boys Club, that's coming. We're working on something right now. Sorry if I missed somebody's comments. Trying to like pay attention. Post-processing your bases later. So yeah, like what I was saying earlier with this Reese, I like to parallel process my bass just to split the low end from the mids and the highs. Then like distortion. See what other honorable mentions are there. I love trash. OTT is obviously a go-to. Fucking, good shit. Oh, I'll show you something cool before I go. So, I don't know how many people use this. Maybe it's just me, but. So, ring modulation, I think is really cool for like the really high end. Here, let's pull up the sound again. No high end. Little fucking high, like noisy artifacts. Really cool to have, especially if you after that you if you're making a fill, you can put this sound in the middle and then you can send that highs to a channel and like you mute the middle and you really gain the sides. It's gonna give you like a bite through the mix. So, learned that one from Culprit. It's a cool technique because, yeah. But you can't have it all the time like that because it's gonna blast people's ears. But yeah, okay. Let me keep going. When you started, where did you get the money to buy all this stuff? So, yeah, I was mentioning this earlier. That's like the kind of the kind of, thing where once you start making money from things, like you shouldn't be pirating shit. This is like that's an asshole thing to do. But like when you're just starting up and you're like an up and coming producer and like, you know, you got no money, there's ways to pirate stuff, you know? I'm not saying do it, but yeah. What name comes to your mind that kind of inspired not to quit? Because I know it takes a whole lot of patience. So I'm guessing you're asking what inspired me. Dude, honestly, I just wanted to like, well, I started making music a long time ago and I just wanted to make like rave music because I was like partying and stuff a lot of the time. And then I listened to the old Noisia stuff and I was like, holy shit, like these guys are so far ahead of the game. So I just really wanted to like, I don't know, be better, be good, get better and like keep working. Let's see what else we got. Are all these saved in a playlist? I think this is going to be posted. Yeah, that's what I was told. Yeah, that was the Yellow Claw remix for Amsterdam. What's the hardest part about making a drop? Hardest part about making a drop? I think it's like the hardest part about anything is just to maintain vibe. Because if you don't have a vibe, then like all you have is a bunch of sounds, you know. It's like it sounds simple, but if you don't have a vibe, there's nothing that's gonna attract people's attention to it. So first and foremost, I would design like a groove. So whether it be just like a bass line going like boom 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 boom, I'll just do that with like a sine wave, right? And then I'd be like, okay, like what kind of drums would like fit this? And then I'd add like a kick drum just to fuck around and then be like, well, do I want to saturate this drum? And then like try doing that. And if there's going to be like a vocal, you know, there's like a, you know, there's like a something about having a vocal in a track that just makes things go so much smoother because you just feed off the vocal. So if there's like a drop like an earthquake, you're like, oh shit, like bum 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 bum, you know, you got that rhythm from it. Let's see. This master guy is helpful as fuck. Yeah, I'm glad it helps, dude. I tried my best to with the short amount of time that I got. And, like, you know, a lot of the sound design stuff, you're just messing around half the time. You're making estimated guesses, and then you see how it sounds. And then if it doesn't sound good, you go back, and then you try something else, you know. When do you know when a track is finished? Yo, a track's never done, dude. Ask Yellow Claw and ask them how fucking long Mean Silas finished tracks, dude. Do we have projects there like from 4 years ago where like it's not done yet? Yeah, that Ramen Girl track, that's exactly the one, dude. It's coming and it's coming though. It's already finished. Like I think they're filming a music video in Tokyo or something. And but this coronavirus kind of set everything back. What do you do when a song is finished but you're not happy with it, I guess? Is that what you mean? But you're happy with it? Like, when a song is finished and you're happy with it, you're fucking good to go. But you're never going to be happy with it. That's the problem. So at some point, that's when you need those external ears to tell you, like, yo, stop working on it. This is already sounding dope. And just stop. So it's important to have friends at that point. So it's something we never knew about production. I don't know, bro. I don't know what you know or you don't know. I've been showing a bunch of shit. I think, like, not a lot of people know about this Echo Boy delay stereo placement. I don't think a lot of people know about ring modulator. I don't know. Like, if you want me to flex, I'll flex on you, dude. Such a rude comment, dude. I'm trying to help you. Here. This is my flex. Do you know how to use Falcon? Probably not. So, is it granular hybrid analog synthesizer? You can use granular synthesis to make vocals into a synth, essentially. And you have like control of like a 512 different grains, and this is just a beast of a plugin. So you have control within each tree you have control of the nodes, which then get controlled by the key groups and then the layers. So if I wanted to have chords, let's say, I could set the bass note of the chord to be one node, and then the second note of the chord will be a different, oscillated completely, and then another third or the fifth of the chord, I would have another node all in one synth, and then they would blend together at the top of the layers, and I have control over the pitch of every single different note. And then with the granular synthesis, dude, like, it's unlimited potential. So something you didn't know about, douche. How you mix your drums, a lot of it is like EQ, compression, and just making sure things don't collapse. When you have too many things going on, they're like, they get too muddy, and they just block each other out. So you got to make sure you have drums in a space that has room for it. So if you have a bunch of like high-end and mid-range in your lead sound, you don't need to put a bunch of the drums that have the same kind of tonality in it, because it's going to get masked. So what you do is like you add like overheads and like high snares and not snares, but like hi-hats and cymbals, and you put them on top of the sound, and then you have like your kick that's going to be in the middle, and there's going to be side chaining with the bass, so that way the bass doesn't like muffle the kick. And then yeah, it's just it's a whole masterclass on its own. Like mixing drums is a, yeah, it's a lot of work. This is just supposed to be like a quick little bass thing. Yeah. So if you're not happy with the track, and you but your like a song is finished, just put it out, man. What's the worst that can happen? Like people don't like it, be like, oh, this guy fell off. Like I want some of the old shit. It's like whatever, dude. I don't give a shit. And you can always make it better in the future. You know, you make a new track in the future. Don't like overwork one project. Just start on something new that you feel like happy about. Is this stream there in Twitch? I don't have Twitch, but I don't know. Maybe Bron's going to want to do things on Twitch. Maybe another question. Is there a track you think you would be able to make better now you look back? Dude, yeah, every track. Like, every track I make, I get better from it, right? And when you look back, you're like, oh, shit, like, I should have done this way. Like, why did I distort this? And, like, you know, but whatever. Some mistakes actually turn out to be kind of like the spice in the track. You're like, oh, I didn't expect that, and like sprinkle some mistakes on it. Sounds good. Sesco, again, dude, I don't know, man. I don't know. I'm not Sesco. Call him, dude. Call Danny right now. A native instrument's form is similar to Falcon. Yeah, but Falcon's a bit more powerful. How do you manage in a collab? Well, it depends who you're collabing with. If you have like a lot of people just try to collab for like the fucking, the name and like recognition. And so like, you know, I want to collab with Steve Aoki because he's a big name, blah, 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 blah. Like I would never fucking do a collab with Steve Aoki just because like, I don't think I would vibe with him. Like, I don't mean he's a bad guy. It's just like our sounds are so different. I don't know him, so you know, like some people don't care about that. I care about like having like a relationship with the person I'm collabing with, and then we can get on good in the studio. We like talk, feel each other out, like no homo, but you know, try to like get on like the same level and then try to jam, and then you get something cool or you don't, and then no stress. What do you think of your fans? I love my fans, dude. It's super trippy to think about like me having fans, because like I'm just a dude and just trying to make some music. So it's cool that people are enjoying it, and I'm trying to give back as best as I can to everybody, all the knowledge, and yeah. Love the fans. Rock here. Hello, bro. Hello from Indonesia. Hello, guys. I'm from Canada. Yeah, man. Thanks for your comments, Dennis. I'm glad it helped. Anyway, guys, I'm going to get out of here. Because, yeah, I got to go. But if you have any questions, just hit me up on Instagram or whatever. Just slide in the DMs. If I missed anybody's comment, I'm sorry. I'll try my best. Anyway, have a good night, guys. And have a good day if you're just waking up. And hopefully I see you soon.